Hi friends, welcome to our channel Global Health Helpline. Today we will learn about the Hahnemann's Great Polycrest Remedy Aconite Napolis from the book Lectures on Homeopathic Materia Medica by James Tyler Kent. It is the second part including the points throat, palate and tonsils, stomach, liver, abdomen, urinary organs, genital, throat, lungs and respiration, extremities, relations. Please subscribe our channel to be connected with us. Let's begin. Throat, palate and tonsils. Aconite is a very useful medicine in inflammation of the throat, when there is burning, smarting, dryness, great redness of the tonsils, or the fossa, the whole throat. Sometimes the soft palate is greatly swollen. A high grade of inflammation, acute inflammation of all that can be seen and called throat. But that alone would not indicate aconite. It cures that kind of case, it cures inflammation of the throat, but every homeopathic physician knows that 40 or 50 remedies could be selected just as well. As aconite from all that I have said. I have only mentioned a nondescript case. No homeopathic physician could prescribe upon that kind of evidence. But you note the kind of throat, every physician must ask himself the question. What would make that kind of a throat an aconite case? And then the question would come up, could he not prescribe for it as well if he had not seen the throat? The throat does not do much towards representing, to an intelligent physician, the patient. If it was necessary to represent to the mind of the physician the inflamed part itself, how would he treat the liver? He cannot see it. How would he prescribe for the stomach? He cannot see it. We are then compelled to fall back upon that which represents to the intelligent physician the very nature of the patient himself, and then at once we will see the reason for some of these things. If you present an aconite patient well before the mind, you can prescribe. It would be well to see anything that is visible. If you could see the liver, I would say look at it. If you could see the heart, I would say examine it. What is it in this throat that really represents the patient? Of course, any soreness of the throat makes it difficult to swallow. I mean to infer that there is nothing in the soreness to represent to the physician the aconite patient. If that individual were a plethoric individual, if he had been riding in a cold, raw wind a good part of the day, and he had wakened in the night with a violent burning, tearing sore throat, and he could not swallow, and the fever came on high, and he had thirst for cold water and he could not get enough of it, he was in an anxious, feverish state, you have then a patient to prescribe for. Many times will patients become intelligent enough under your observation to write just what some mem. bear of the family acts like. You know just what the patient looks like. The black man will sometimes give the best kind of a description, better than the Vasa girl, who writes us. Doctor, will you please send the medicine have looked into the throat and it is red. Quote, stomach. With the stomach symptoms, what an anxious patient we have. The pains are dreadful. Burning pains, tearing pains, with anxiety, with restlessness, with fever, coming on from taking cold, not from overeating, but from taking cold, which has settled in the stomach. From exposure to an ice bath, or in a very hot summer from intense heat, associated with an irritable brain in vigorous children. Vomiting and retching, tearing, as it were, the very inside out by the awful retching. The vomiting of blood, bright red blood. This is descriptive of the general stomach trouble. During this febrile state he craves bitter things, wine and beer and brandy, but they will come up as soon as they reach the stomach. He craves pungent things, nothing tastes bitter enough. If he could only get something bitter. And yet his food tastes bitter, everything he eats tastes bitter, everything except water. The word in the text is a clinical word. It says gastric catarrh. It is a very sharp, acute inflammation of the stomach. Retching, vomiting of bile, vomiting of blood. Ineffectual urging to vomit when there is nothing in the stomach. With it there will be anxiety, restlessness, fear of death. The fear depicted upon the countenance makes an awful expression. Aconite is a useful medicine in inflammation of the liver, when it comes suddenly. It is not very useful in repeated attacks, but in the first attack. Liver. Violent inflammation of the liver, with violent tearing pains and much burning. Then comes the restlessness, the awful tortures of anxiety, moving constantly, fear of death, red face, glassy eyes, great thirst. Anxious restlessness covers nearly all of these things. Abdomen. In the abdomen there are shooting pains, burning, stinging pains after exposure to cold, becoming chilled. We will soon come to think that it does not make much difference where the disorder occurs, we must have the aconite patty. Ent. We also have inflammatory troubles of all the viscera of the abdomen. It may be a violent catarrhal inflammation. It may be a catarrhal condition of the lower portion of the colon, or a catarrhal condition of the rectum, when we will have a dysentery. In dysentery, that which is found in the commode is almost pure blood and a little slime. It seems impossible for him to leave the commode. Vomiting a little blood and passing bloody mucus from the rectum. Always they will predict they will die tonight or in a few hours. They look as if they realize the sensation of death. The whole body is in a state of anguish, but the tenesmus and cramp, the urging to stool are simply terrible. It has a watery diarrhea, but that is not a very important symptom, although it is doubly marked in herring. But when pure blood is passed, and mucus, with tenesmus, or when a little green mucus is passed by infants with summer troubles, pure blood or grass green discharges with fever coming on suddenly, in bright, rosy little ones, think of aconite. Most of the bowel troubles come on from intense heat, in the children. The infant takes on inflammation of the liver from the heat, and the stool becomes white like milk, of putty consistency. The child becomes yellow and screams with pain. Urinary organs. It is useful in urinary troubles, bladder and kidney troubles, inflammatory conditions, and with bloody urine. Scanty urine, suppressed urine, or retained urine. Retention from shock. This retention from shock makes it one of our best remedies for retention in the newborn. The infant just born into the world has undergone a shock. At your next visit, the nurse says, the child has not passed urine. The functions of that little one are not yet established because of the great shock the little one has gone through. Inflammation of the bladder, with cutting, tearing pains. Burning pains with burning urine. Urine is hot, dark, colored red, red and clear, or bloody. Retention from cold, especially in children, with crying and restlessness. With inflammatory conditions of the bladder, either in adults or in infants, there will be all the mental states representing the aconite patient. Genital. Aconite cures most violent cases of otitis, which come on suddenly. Otitis from cold, from being chilled, in plethoric men. But in the common otitis from suppressed gonorrheal discharges, aconite is useless. The woman is a natural aconite patient with her sympathetic natural sensitiveness. She usually takes on complaints from nervous shock, from fear, and she naturally takes on complaints from causes other than those from which men take on sickness. It is very seldom that fear will give a man inflammation, but fear is a common cause of inflammation of the uterus and of the ovaries in plethoric, vigorous, excitable women. Fear will often cause abortion, but when aconite is given early enough, it will check the abortion that comes from fear. We will have the stitching, burning, tearing pains of aconite sometimes following fear or sudden emotion. Sometimes a pregnant woman will say, doctor, there is no use your planning for my confinement. I know I am going to die in that confinement. If there is any one thing that is a really strong symptom to prescribe on it is that a dose of aconite, and then change the subject, she goes away, and in a few days you ask her about that fear and she says, oh, never mind that. Quote, many little things like that can be singled out. But that state of fear is a very peculiar thing, and really represents the whole nature and being of the woman. She predicts the day of her death. The reason that aconite is so often the infant's remedy is because the infant is so often made sick. From fright. Inflammation of the genitals in plethoric women. Aconite is more frequently indicated in women and children than in men. Sensitive, vigorous, excitable women. It is indicated in men in inflammatory conditions from becoming chilled in dry, cold air, and it is wonderful how you can see. Convince a patient who needs aconite what wonderful things there are in homeopathy by showing him how rapidly, with aconite, you can put him in a sweat and break up a sharp fever when that is a recent and single attack. After tedious and difficult parturition. Violent after pains. Shooting, tearing after pains, with febrile conditions. Uterine hemorrhage with bright red blood and fear of death. It is wonderful what aconite will do in some cases arising from taking cold in the puerperal state, but do not mix tea. Hat up with puerperal fever. The first is a simple form, non-septic, perhaps the breast is involved, with soreness in the breast, suppression of the milk and febrile conditions, but if there is suppression of the lochia, do not give aconite. Newborn children, with difficulty of breathing after the use of forceps, or from a tedious labor, the child is breathless, there is difficulty with the heart, and in a few hours fever comes on. Aconite is a very simple remedy. The retention of urine in the infant is so commonly an aconite condition that you will hardly ever need to use any other medicine. The little one cannot yet talk, it cannot manifest very much, and, to a certain extent, the practitioner is compelled to be somewhat routine in these affairs, and they are. Routine practitioners have been more or less successful with aconite for the retention of the urine. Again, it is true that in many cases of retention of the urine in the mother, it will disappear after a dose of causticum. Throat. Aconite is a great routine croup remedy, one that is misused, but it is indicated in all those cases of croup which come on suddenly in plethoric children, from exposure to dry cold wind, having been out in the cold wind with the mother during the day. The child is put to bed and rouses up from the first sleep, perhaps at 9 or 10 or 11 o'clock, grasps the throat, coughs violently, a croupy, choking cough with horse bark. Hardly any other remedy can correspond to that rapidity of action, taking cold in the daytime and developing itself so sudden. Lie. Croup that comes on from exposure today, and does not develop until tomorrow morning or tomorrow evening, may correspond to quite a number of other remedies, but especially heper, which is slower in its pace. And it is more suitable in children somewhat run down and subject to frequent attacks of croup. Spongier is also similar, but it lacks many of the elements more likely to occur in run down children, those always taking cold. It would be a difficult matter to distinguish between the appearance of the aconite and the spongier croup so far as the croup is concerned, because both have all the anxious appearance found in croup. The aconite croup is a violent croup, inflammation of the larynx, and, at the same time, spasms of the larynx coming on with great rapidity. The spongier croup is less inflammatory, the inflammation grows with the spasms. But while spongier may rouse up at 11 o'clock at night, suffocating and choking, it has not the intense febrile excitement that belongs to aconite, nor the anguish, although it has all the dryness that is found in aconite. Aconite conditions are dry as a usual thing, or there is only a little watery discharge. Spongier is entirely dry, if there is an inflamed mucous membrane, it is dry. We have in the croup symptoms in aconite, larynx sensitive to touch. Croup waking in first sleep after exposure to dry cold winds. Lungs and respiration. Aconite is full of disturbances of respiration, dyspnea from contraction of the smaller bronchial tubes, which we find resembles asthma. It is indicated in that dyspnea that belongs to capillary bronchitis, in that dyspnea that belongs to cardiac excitement in plethoric persons, from taking cold, becoming exposed or from shock. Dyspnea from fear, such as occurs in nervous women, excitable, easily affected, nervous, plethoric women. Breathing short, labored, anxious, quick. It is an asthmatic dyspnea and there is usually dryness of the mucous membranes of the small bronchial tubes. Sits up straight and can hardly breathe. Aconite has such a sudden violent cardiac irritation, pulse fluttering, weak, full and bounding, sits up in bed, grasps the throat, wants everything thrown off, before midnight, a hot skin, great thirst, great fear, everything is associated together. Anguish with dyspnea. Sudden attacks of pain in the heart with dyspnea. All go together. Great suffocation. From this fear and from anxiety he breaks out in profuse sweat, he is drenched with sweat, and yet he is hot. When this anxiety passes off he becomes hot. So there is heat and sweat with this awful anxiety. Pulse like a thread. Better during expiration. The spasm of the larynx often comes on during inspiration. Worse during inspiration. Constant short, dry cough. Difficult breathing. Breathes only with the diaphragm. Chest troubles, such as pneumonia. Aconite produces a very rapid inflammation of the viscera of the chest, of the pleura, of the lungs, of the mucous membrane lining the air passages. In pneumonia we have this dyspnea, the suddenness with which it comes on. If it spreads rapidly it may go into pneumonia. Inflammation runs so high that the mucous membrane oozes blood, cherry red, or the mucus that comes up as white and heavily streaked with bright red blood. You go to the bedside of bronchopneumonia and you will find in the pan mucus streaked with bright red blood. Now, take the violence with which that comes on, the restlessness and anxiety of the individual, he predicts the hour of his death, that would be the case with the aconite patient. In the case of pneumonia where the lung is involved, it is likely to be the upper half of the left lung when aconite is indicated. Sometimes the whole mucous membrane, the visible throat, the larynx, trachea, the bronchial tubes, will all lose blood, sometimes a mouthful of blood, so violent is the inflammation. In these chest troubles there is much pain. Shooting, burning, tearing pains, and the patient is compelled to lie in a somewhat elevated position, on the back. Cannot lie upon either side, but upon the back. Lying on the side increases the pain. The dry cold winds. Sudden shocks, in persons of good, strong, vigorous circulation. The hemoptysis that is spoken of is not such as occurs in phthisis, but is involuntary. The blood comes up with a slight cough. Someone might be deceived to give it in such cases in broken down constitutions in sickly patients, but it is not to be administered in such cases, we have much better remedies. The patient does not always become a pneumonia patient, but inflammation of the small air passages may be all that is present. Dry cough, vomiting and retching, intense fever, spitting of blood. No expectoration except a little watery mucus and blood. It occurs a good deal in this way. Dry cough, sensation of dryness of the whole chest, sensation of dryness in the larynx and throat. Pours down great quantities of cold water, and once in a while after a violent coughing spell he gets up a little blood. But the expectoration is generally mucus. Pneumonia is generally attended with an expectoration looking like iron rust, as if iron rust had been mixed in with it. Such medicines as Bryonia and Rustox, and a few others have that expectoration as a common feature, as natural to the remedies themselves. Yes, but aconite is the cherry, red, bright red expectoration. Its hemorrhages are bright red and sometimes copious. All these coughs and pneumonia, in croup and chest troubles come on suddenly, and if he goes to sleep he will have spasm of the larynx with dryness of the larynx. He goes to sleep and the larynx becomes dry and he wakes up and grasps his larynx, he thinks he is going to choke. All these come on from cold winds. Vigorous persons get into a draft and get a chill that will bring on aconite symptoms. Aconite has in all inflamed parts a sensation as if hot steam were rushing into the parts, as if warm blood were rushing into the parts, or flushes of heat in the parts. Along nerves, a sensation of heat or sensation of cold. The pulse in the highest form of the fever is full and bounding, strong, vigorous pulse. When the attack is first coming on and the awful anxiety and nerve tension are present, the pulse is very small, but after the heart's action is well established, then the pulse becomes stronger. Tearing pains down the spine. Painful, stiff neck. Crawling in the spine like insects. That is a peculiar feature, this crawling sensation, it comes from cold, from being suddenly chilled. Extremities. Trembling of the hands associated with these sudden acute attacks. Creeping pains in the fingers associated with these sudden acute inflammatory attacks. Cold as ice. Feet cold as ice. Hot palms. Quote. Hot hands and cold feet are sometimes present. Rheumatic conditions of the joints. Those that come on as a first attack. Not all rheumatic and gouty attacks, but those that come on as acute rheumatism, those that come on from sudden exposure to cold, from long rides in a dry, cold wind. They also are attended with fever, with anxious restlessness, with a critical state of mind so often described. Trembling, tingling, convulsions of the muscles. But the nerves are full of aconite symptoms and aconite sufferings. Aconite is a wonderful remedy for neuritis in plethoric persons. Numbness along the course of the nerves, from cold, from exposure. Numbness and tingling, along the course of the nerves, especially those that run close to the surface. Inflammation of the nerve sheaths. Nervous excitability. Excessive restlessness. Relations. Sulfur has a strong relation to aconite. It has many aconite symptoms. In many of the old chronic cases where sulfur would be used in strong, vigorous constitutions, aconite will be suitable for a sudden attack, and sulfur for the chronic. In sudden attacks that aconite conforms to, that is the whole attack, there may be left in that constitution a tendency to return of a similar attack. Aconite has no power over that tendency, but sulfur has. Of course, most of the symptoms must agree, but it will seem to you frequently where aconite has been suitable in the acute disease that sulfur symptoms will follow, and many times a very violent attack leaves a weakness in the constitution which aconite has no power to contend with. It has no power to keep off recurrent attacks. It does all that it is capable of doing, and that is the end of it. But it is not so with sulfur. After aconite follow well arnica and belladonna. Sometimes it is true it will appear to you that aconite is capable of coping with all there is in the disease. But there seems to be a lingering something that holds on, and such medicines as arnica and bel, and ipecuche and bright do have to come in to finish up the attack, or sometimes sulfur. Very commonly silica. So we have to study the relations of medicines. If you have administered aconite in too many doses, or given it too strong, and your patient is slow in recovering from the attack, or your patient has taken aconite himself and